Good afternoon, everyone. I'm very happy to invite you all for the week two of the Global Pediatric Lecture Series. We had a fantastic session last week on hyperglycemia. We were delighted to see hundreds of you joining from all over the globe, and the amount of interaction was amazing, actually. So thank you so much for all your contribution and making this program a great success. We're looking forward to a delightful session today. So I would now welcome my co-organizer, Dr. Ami Das, to introduce the speaker of the day. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Senthil. Welcome to Liverpool, all of you. And I have a great pleasure in introducing Dr. Kamran Mahmood, who is the speaker today, and he will be discussing juvenile idiopathic arthritis, what's latest. Dr. Mahmood is a consultant pediatric rheumatologist at Alder Hey, which is a center of excellence for juvenile lupus. His special interest is in inflammatory bone disease and autoinflammatory conditions. He is an international lead on clinical research in chronic non-bacterial osteomyelitis. He also leads the International Rheumatology Fellowship Program at Alder Hey, and I will now hand over to him. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Das, for your kind words. It's really a great honor to present on this forum, and I think all the organizers, especially you and Dr. Sanipan and Jody, you all need a round of applause for organizing this. I welcome everyone who joined us virtually on behalf of our rheumatology team and our organizing team. I hope you will enjoy today's lecture. So without any delay, I will start my presentation. I'm going to talk a little bit about juvenile idiopathic inflammatory arthritis, what options we have when we are treating inflammatory arthritis, and allegedly when we don't have any options, what can we then do? So first of all, I have no conflict of interest and have no external funding for this presentation. However, all the slides are from contributions from all the team members, so I want to acknowledge all of them. And I'm also very glad that I don't need to tell you about emergency exits, as it's unlikely to have any fire incident where I am. So this is our lovely hospital and lovely rheumatology team. I'm somewhere here between these two lovely ladies. This is the main hospital that we have, and obviously this is pre-corona, so you can see a lot of people walking around in the atrium, which is the main social hub in our hospital. And from an aerial view, this is how Alder Hey Hospital looks like, a beautiful Teletubby building. So the outline of today's talk is we're going to talk about juvenile idiopathic inflammatory arthritis, how we do stepwise treatment from level 1 to level 3, and what advanced treatment options we have available at the moment, including surgical options and bone marrow transplant, and what future holds for us when it comes to difficult patients. So before I start explaining different options, I just want to emphasize that in medicine and in life, there are always options. I have always felt that we are very blessed, and we are especially working in teams, that we are never optionless. So juvenile idiopathic arthritis, as the name indicates, juvenile means that it's before 16th birthday. Idiopathic means that we actually don't know why children get this. Arthritis means inflammation of the joint. But very important points, the last two points, that it has to persist for at least 6 weeks and other known conditions excluded. Now, it seems a relatively easy job to do to exclude other known conditions. But I'll explain in next slide that sometimes it can be quite tricky to exclude all of the possibilities. What it is not is that it is not juvenile rheumatoid arthritis, it's not juvenile chronic arthritis, and it's definitely not Still's disease. So in this picture, I just wanted to highlight that this is some of the conditions that we faced with to exclude when we make a diagnosis of inflammatory arthritis. And some of these are relatively straightforward, and some of these are a little bit difficult to exclude without significant investigations. However, it is very important to always consider trauma and non-accidental injury in young people with unexplained joint pains. Also to look for bone malignancies. A lot of systemic conditions such as inflammatory bowel disease, systemic vasculitis, and periodic fever syndromes, they can present with arthropathies, and a lot of chromosomal conditions such as Down's, Turner's, and some immunodeficiency syndromes, they can also present with arthropathies. A lot of time, relatively benign mechanical conditions can present with intermittent joint pains and swelling, such as overuse syndromes and joint hypermobility. So it's very important to acknowledge these as well. So as per International League Against Rheumatism classification, JIA is classified into oligoarticular JIA, rheumatoid factor positive and negative poly-JIA, psoriatic JIA, enthesitis-related JIA, systemic JIA, and undifferentiated. As you can see from this slide, that oligoarticular JIA is the most common subtype, and it constitutes at least half of the pediatric population that presents. All the different types of JIA are common to much more common in female, except enthesitis-related arthritis, which is more common in males, and systemic arthritis has similar sex ratio. Most arthritis types of arthritis have early onset, such as oligo and polyrheumatoid and psoriatic, but some arthritis such as psoriatic and polyarticular JIA can have biphasic peaks and early age and slightly early teenage as well. Systemic arthritis can present in any age group. So this is just a couple of pictures to show what extra features children with systemic arthritis, systemic onset JIA can have. So as you can, it's very hard to see from these slides, but systemic onset JIA patients typically get a rash which comes and goes with the fever. This temperature chart shows you the spikes of fever, and usually systemic JIA patients get a pattern of fever, so 2 to 3 spikes or 4 spikes every day. And as the disease progresses, they can have hepatosplenomegaly and other features of systemic serositis as well. Because of copyright acts and patient confidentiality, I have to remove some pictures of poly-JIA, but you can see from these pictures that multiple joints in the hands are involved under both sides, and any patient who had 4 or more joints involved at presentation will be classified as polyarticular JIA. Psoriatic arthritis typically will have a rash consistent with psoriasis and features of dactylitis, and most of the time they have features of enthesitis as well. So a little bit more about juvenile psoriatic arthritis. As I explained earlier in one of the slides, that there are 2 peaks of juvenile psoriatic arthritis. The younger patients tend to have more dactylitis and small joint involvement. They tend to have ANA positivity, and they more commonly progress to polyarticular course. In general, they take twice the time of any other arthritis to get into clinical remission. The older patients, the older peak patients with psoriatic arthritis usually present with enthesitis-related arthritis and axial arthropathy. So their hip joints and sacroiliac joints and spinal involvement. And sometimes they have persistent oligo-JIA involving either one knee or one ankle persistently, or sometimes it just involves their fingers and toes. Cystitis related arthritis, as you can see, you can probably guess from the definition that this is a type of arthritis which involves inflammation of enthesis. Enthesis is the area where tendons are joined with the bones. So on these pictures, you can see Achilles tendon inflammation of the ankle joints in a young child and an older child. The picture of eye is showing scleritis. So other patients, most inflammatory arthritis patients will have associated uveitis. However, cystitis related arthritis tends to develop more iritis and scleritis than uveitis. So are investigations important in the diagnosis of inflammatory arthritis, and do they help? They do help to exclude other causes, but normal investigation does not exclude inflammatory arthritis, and very abnormal investigation doesn't necessarily confirm the diagnosis of inflammatory arthritis. So as you can see on this investigation chart, patients with systemic GIA typically will have raised inflammatory markers, negative autoantibodies, but they will have anemia. The rest of the inflammatory arthritis will either have normal blood counts or and normal platelets, or normal hemoglobin with slightly raised platelets. Except oligoarthritis, rest of the types of arthritis can have mild to moderately raised inflammatory markers. Oligoarthritis typically have normal inflammatory markers, and they have at least 2/3 of them are usually ANA positive. Rheumatoid factor negative poly-GIA, as the name indicates, are usually rheumatoid factor negative and can be ANA positive or negative, and vice versa for polyrheumatoid factor positive. Psoriatic arthritis tend to be ANA positive, and those with axial disease tend to be HLA-B27 positive. And cystitis-related arthritis tends to be HLA-B27 positive, and usually antibody positivity in enthesitis-related and psoriatic arthritis is not a good prognostic sign. So diagnosis of GIA, as you have probably guessed by now, that its clinical diagnosis is based on history and examination. So diagnosis is based on typical inflammatory pain, which comes with the rest and gets better with movement, early morning stiffness and joint swelling, and any other indicators such as eye signs in uveitis, bowel signs in inflammatory bowel disease, temperature and low cell counts in systemic arthritis, any family history of arthritis. Bloods, as I mentioned earlier, can be helpful sometimes. So autoantibodies help to define prognosis and to classify. Inflammatory markers are usually not very helpful unless they are significantly abnormal. We tend not to do X-rays unless we have to exclude other causes. And sometime in polyarticular GIA patients, we do baseline X-rays to look for the amount of damage that's been done. Nowadays, ultrasound is our first line investigation because it's cheap, easily available, and very user friendly for children. However, when we are in doubt, we tend to use MRI with contrast very often, especially with the axial arthropathy and hip joints. Treatment of GIA, like any other chronic illness and inflammatory problem, treatment aim is to get disease control and get into remission as quickly as possible with as little medication as possible, and then continue to have symptomatic improvement in the quality of life by improving the stiffness, the pain, and the range of movement. The long-term aim of treatment is to keep a patient in remission, prevent joint damage, and to give these children a normal growth and development to enable them to have normal education and normal adolescent period, and to ensure that they don't get any long-term eye damage from untreated uveitis. So most of our arthritis patients, they get uveitis screening regularly to look for any chronic and look for any anterior uveitis, which is usually quite silent to present. So in terms of treatment, so step one treatment for oligoarticular GIA would be focused intraarticular steroid injections after the course of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medication. However, in patients with polyarticular GIA presentation, we tend to start them on systemic steroids in the form of intravenous methyl blood, followed by a course of oral steroids, and we also start them on systemic disease modifying agents, the first line being methotrexate. The dose that we tend to use in children with inflammatory problems is 15 milligram per meter square, and we cap it at 25 milligram as maximum dose. And of course, after receiving intravenous steroids, we reassess them, and those joints that still are symptomatic, those joints get intraarticular steroid injections. In terms of systemic management, we tend to use methotrexate. Comes in different preparations, so it can be given via oral route, both in liquid and tablet form, and can be given as subcutaneously as well. And in some units, it can be given as intravenous. Some units prefer to use methotrexate as subcutaneous route because of concerns about absorption and compliance when taken via oral route. Our first line preference is to give subcutaneous methotrexate, especially in poly-GIA. However, in children who have significant fear of needles, there's no reason why it can't be given via oral route. We move on to next level of treatment if we fail to get any remission in 3 months, there is any significant side effects such as persistent abnormal liver function with methotrexate, or recurrent infections. Sometimes children just cannot tolerate methotrexate because of side effects of sickness. So level two treatment is biologic treatment. So in the last 20 years, the treatment of arthritis has been revolutionized because of invent of modern biologic medications. So nowadays, over 95% of children can get a clinically inactive disease as described in this paper. However, as you can see from the other paper, that at least half of these patients require at least one biologic to attain clinically inactive disease, which is quite a significant number. And it also means that invent of biologic means that we are getting into the getting these patients into the mission quickly, treating them very well, and therefore we are avoiding long-term complications such as joint replacements. So just a little bit of basic science slide about biologics. So biologics are biosynthesized chemicals that mostly work by competing at different cytokines and inflammatory cells on either on their receptors or block their pathways. So here you can see that ustekinumab, which is a IL-23/12 blocker, it works by blocking these receptors. Tocilizumab, which is IL-6 blocker, it works by blocking the IL-6 receptors. Similarly, the rituximab CD20 blocker, and again the IL-1 blocker. So the most common used biologic medications are anti-tumor necrosis factor, and the most common types are either monoclonal antibodies such as infliximab, adalimumab, certolizumab, and glimumab, or with a circulating receptor fusion protein, chimeric protein such as etanercept. We in rheumatology, we don't use infliximab very often now, as it's mainly because of superior medical effect of other anti-TNF, and also the better route that we use other medications. So etanercept is usually our first line biologic to give. It can be given subcutaneously once to twice a weekly. When we see patients with flare up or when disease needs better control, we tend to give it 0.4 milligram per kilogram twice weekly. When patients are in remission, we can switch it to 0.8 milligram per kilogram once a week. And with the maximum dose at capped at 50 milligram per week. Adalimumab is also first line biologic treatment, mainly for all types of arthritis, but especially for GIA-related uveitis patients, since the extremely useful and beneficial results came out from Sycamore trial. Adalimumab dosing is relatively straightforward. It's under 30 kilogram and over 30 kilogram dosing. So 20 milligram every 2 weeks, for under 30 kilogram and 40 milligram every 2 weeks for over 30 kilogram. Our second line biologic is tocilizumab. Tocilizumab is IL-6 blocker. It is fully human IL-6 receptor monoclonal antibody. It's a second line biologic for inflammatory arthritis. However, it is first line for systemic onset GIA. It can be given either via IV infusion or subcut preparation. The dose of tocilizumab is 8 milligram per kilo. 8 milligram per kilogram for more than 30 kilogram patients and 12 milligram per kilogram for under 30 kilogram patients, and we give it once a month. Sarilumab is also IL-6 blocker, which is currently in trial. Our next biologic is IL-1 blocker, which is two biologics are well-known, anakinra and canakinumab. Anakinra comes in a preparation that needs to be given once every day, and canakinumab can be given once every 4 weeks. IL-1 blocker is extremely good for systemic GIA as well as macrophage activation syndrome associated with inflammatory problems. Third line biologics that we tend to use are abatacept and rituximab. So abatacept is a selective T cell co-stimulatory modulator. We give it every 4 weeks to patients who fail to respond to anti-TNF and IL blockade. The usual dose is 10 milligram per kilogram infusion. In last 18 months or so, we now have availability of subcut abatacept as well, that some of our patients are using now. In patients who tend who fail to respond to other biologics, especially in patients who are rheumatoid factor positive poly-GIA and have some element of associated Sjogren's, the rituximab can be used. It's an anti-CD20 monoclonal antibody, and it can be given as 750 milligram per meter square to a maximum dose of 1 gram on day 1 and day 15. Further doses depends upon the clinical response. The important thing to remember that the rituximab has very strong immunosuppression, and sometimes it completely wipes out the B cells. So therefore, it's very important to monitor immunoglobulins and look for any signs of infection. And most of the time, we keep these patients on prophylactic antibiotics as well. So this automatically raises a question: that are biologics safe? I think they are safe as long as we treat them, we use them with respect, as long as we use them on merit and we are careful about risk of infection. They are very safe if there is a good system of monitoring. We also need to remember that when we start patients on biologic, we need to consider the length of treatment. This is not a treatment that can be given for infinite period. If your patient on biologic is not responded in 6 months, it's unlikely that patient will respond in 12 months. And similarly, if your patient has been well and had no episodes on biologic for 18 months to 2 years, then that's the time when we should start thinking of slowly taking them off biologic. We need to consider the long-term risk of biologics, both in terms of infection and individual risk factors associated with malignancies and some other conditions. In terms of cost effectiveness, we think that biologics are very cost effective in long term. When you look at the bigger picture, they are relatively expensive to begin with. But once you look at the picture of getting arthritis under control quickly, therefore avoiding all the comorbidities and all the other effects of health and socioeconomic system, and then they definitely are cost effective. And with the invent of biosimilars, the biologics are not as expensive as it used to be. And in some cases, biologics are actually cheaper than traditional DMARDs. When we use biologics for long term, we need to, there's some good work that has been done mostly in Austria and Switzerland, which has shown the use of biologics in long term without any system, without any conventional DMARD such as methotrexate or azathioprine or hydroxychloroquine or even MMF can lead to develop resistance in the body by developing biologic-associated antibodies. So a lot of work has been done to look for adalimumab-associated antibodies, and there is significant data to confirm which shows that patients who received even a small dose of methotrexate alongside adalimumab had no to very low incidence of developing adalimumab-associated antibodies. So I think it's important that even in those patients who are not very keen to continue taking methotrexate, it's important to keep this option open, and even a small dose can help in a long way. So what future holds in terms of biologics and medical treatments? So I think the most exciting medication at the moment is JAK inhibitors. So unfortunately, I can't share the slides of their biochemistry because they were copyrighted, but JAK inhibitors are Janus kinase inhibitors. And unlike other biologic treatments, they actually block multiple inflammatory pathways. However, the effect of immunosuppression in terms of risk to infection in adult studies have shown to be less than traditional or conventional biologics. The most exciting benefit of JAK kinase inhibitor, especially in children, that it can be that they are oral and very easy to take. Adult trials of JAK kinase inhibitors has been done both in arthritis and other systemic inflammatory conditions such as lupus as well. And currently we are, our center is part of a multi-center international study where we're looking at use of baricitinib, which is one of the JAK kinase inhibitors in patients with arthritis and systemic JIA, as well as uveitis associated with arthritis. In terms of surgical options, fortunately, with excellent medical treatment, we now have very few cases that end up needing surgical correction or joint replacements. However, there's a small proportion of patients who have very difficult to treat disease, especially patients who have persistent ankle involvement. So in Alder Hey, we have worked very closely with our orthopedic team, and this paper shows our long-term data for patients who had destructive arthropathy involving the ankle joint. We treated these patients with surgical arthrodiastasis with elazoflame, and this has resulted and significantly improved quality of life. And in some patients, it allowed to buy some more time for newer treatments, and also it allowed to avoid irreversible surgical procedures until the more suitable age of skeletal maturity was achieved. So this is how the illustrative frames look like, and with the help of this frame, we slowly, as you can see on the right hand side X-ray picture, that there is absolutely no joint space left. And with the help of frame on the left side, you can see that slowly the joint space has been created in the ankle joint, which results in significant improvement in the pain symptoms and quality of life. Like many other inflammatory conditions, bone marrow transplant definitely has a role in treating inflammatory arthritis, especially those patients who do not respond to treatments. So the first stem cell transplant to treat GIA patients was performed in 1997. Currently, we have relatively strict protocol for the consideration of patients who can have bone marrow transplant, and patients who have very severe progressive disease and they fail to respond to available biologics, usually at least two or three biologics, they can then be assessed for the bone marrow transplant. Currently in UK, we have three centers where they can be assessed for suitability of bone marrow transplant and can receive bone marrow transplant. So in conclusion, juvenile idiopathic inflammatory arthritis is a clinical diagnosis. There are many treatment options available, and in fact, these treatment options are rapidly evolving. And I think the take-home point will be that this is a, like all the long-term conditions, this is a condition that is best managed by a team of people, a team of multi-professionals, and help is always available when people work through networks. So there are lots of networks available across the globe, including American Rheumatology Society, CARA, British Society of Pediatric Rheumatology. So you can always get help through these organizations, or you can ring your friends in Alderhay Hospital, and we're always available to help you via either by ringing or via email. So it's something that gets much better results if we work together. And in the end, I'll just show you that how many people we need to treat rheumatological problems. And when we are not treating patients, we actually enjoy being together. The bottom picture shows one of our Christmas celebrations during our multidisciplinary team meeting. So it's a lot of fun to be part of such a fabulous team. I'm going to end my presentation with these lovely pictures, and I will hand over to Dr. Senapan to pass on any questions if there are any.
Come on, thank you very much for the excellent lecture. It was really, really useful. We've got a few questions here, so I'll start off with the first question from Richard. Are you using anti-CCP in your polypositive children? If so, how are you interpreting the results?
So this is something that we haven't used as a routine. We are definitely using it more often. Mostly we are using it in the patients who are adolescents. And we know that we have the rheumatoid factor results positive. We have a system in our lab which tells us a correlation of anti-CCP positivity, but I think the number that we use, anything over, and this can be different from lab to lab, but my understanding is over 30 is significant. I certainly have patients who are very strongly rheumatoid factor positive, and it correlated with their anti-CCP antibodies being more than 300. So I think it's a very, very, very good test, and probably a little bit more sensitive than rheumatoid factor.
Thank you. We have a question here from Pankaj, and that is, how should general paediatrics look in short for joint issues in routine OPD?
Sorry, Jody, can you repeat that question? My connection here is not very good. So I understood.
How general paediatrics should approach in short for joint issues in routine OPD?
Yeah, so I think this is very, very important because a lot of time patients with arthritis, they don't respond to treatments because of the initial delay in diagnosis. So if we have people who are very conscientious and have a good scheme of examination to see these patients, screen them and refer them to tertiary centers when needed, then there will be a lot less delay. So there is a system of screening these patients called PGALS. It's easily available on Versus Arthritis website, and there is a very good resource available globally in different languages. It's called PMS Matters, Pediatric Musculoskeletal Matters. So if you Google it, you'll find it. It's got lots of videos and question answer sessions and schemes how to look for. But essentially, a good pediatrician taking a detailed history and asking, screening questions about whether it hurts in any joint, when patients come and tell you that it hurts in certain joints, it's important to differentiate whether it's mechanical or inflammatory. Inflammatory pain usually after this. So anyone coming and telling you that they have early morning pain and stiffness for 30 minutes or 1 hour or 2 hours, and it only gets better as the day progresses, as they walk around, this is a strong symptom of inflammatory pain. And essentially, the joint examination is like any other examination. So you do a screening examination by PGALS, and then you look, feel, and move the number of joints where they have problems.
Thank you, Kamran. Next question. I'm from UAE. When should general pediatricians should refer the child to rheumatologist? I'm talking for developing country perspective.
I think management of patient shouldn't get compromised based on where they live. So depending upon what resource you have, you can always manage them, as good as they are in a tertiary center. So it really, in terms of referral, if you have availability of tertiary center, then I think all inflammatory patients should be referred to the rheumatologist. So by that means that if you see a patient who have one swollen knee joint for a number of weeks and you are definite that this is the underlying diagnosis is inflammatory arthritis, then they will need long-term care through the rheumatology team. There is no and it definitely can be done in a combined setting where the care can be shared, like we share care in with our district general hospital colleagues through the tertiary care. But if you are somewhere where you do not have access to tertiary rheumatology care, then it really depends on your skills, that how confident you are with the diagnosis and whether or not you can treat inflammatory patients with joint injections or systemic medication. Joint injection is something that even if you're not in a tertiary center, you can get help with your orthopedic colleagues and get it treated. But I really think that any patient with an underlying inflammatory diagnosis may not need to see rheumatologist all the time, but definitely need to see rheumatologist at least at the time of diagnosis, and then maybe once a year.
Thank you. This is an anonymous question, but it's how do features of JIA differ from that of JRA?
So if you remember my slides, one of the slides say that it's JIA is not JRA. There is no such thing as juvenile rheumatoid arthritis. So the nearest to JRA is polyarticular juvenile idiopathic arthritis rheumatoid factor positive. So these patients are usually teenagers, female patients, and they have number of joints involved at presentation. Now, I'm not sure if the question means that How is it different from adults who develop rheumatoid arthritis? Because adults who develop rheumatoid arthritis usually have smaller joints involved, and it's relatively early than the osteoarthritis picture. However, teenagers with poly-GIA rheumatoid factor positive, they can have any number of joint and any type of joints involved, and they are this is the cohort of patient which is most likely continue to have arthritis through the adulthood and later on in their life. But by definition, JRA is not a diagnosis. It's not in any system of classification.
Thank you, Kamran. Our next question is from Oliver Rackham. What about AB in other biologics? Should we always be trying to continue management?
Santal, can you repeat the question?
What about AB in other biologics? Should we always be trying to continue management?
So I'm struggling to understand what AB
means. I don't know what AB stands for, actually. But we can move on to the next question. How often or frequent can the intra-articular injections be given, steroid injections?
So steroid injections can be given as and when needed basis. Obviously, that doesn't mean that we can give it on a weekly basis, but there's no reason if you have a patient who had joint injection today, there's no reason why they can't have joint injection in 3 months' time or 4 months' time. But if there are patients who are needing joint injections frequently, for example, more than three times a year, that just means that steroid injections are not doing the job and the body is asking for systemic treatment because the inflammation is not responding or only responding temporarily. So while we can still give intra-articular steroid injection, but frequent injection does mean that we should add systemic treatment in the form of steroids, methotrexate, or biologics.
Thank you. Sid has asked, how many patients were successful after having arthrodiastasis surgery in your study?
So this is in part, this is really a good question. And what we, the point I was making that, so this was not a procedure to get rid of arthritis. So this procedure helps us to buy some time to preserve joint, create joint space, improve the quality of life, and then it allow us to wait until until the child achieves skeletal maturity so that proper joint replacement, if needed, can be adopted. So 70% of our patients had really good response to this procedure. However, the procedure, by success, we mean that they had 2 to 3 years of relatively symptom-free period. They managed to go on to next level of treatment, which was not available, for example, 2 years ago, but became available after 2 years, and therefore their arthritis became more controllable. However, it doesn't mean that this procedure helps for arthritis to go away.
Thank you, Kamran. Oliver recommends actually expanded this question from before. It's about the antibodies in other biologics and should we continue methotrexate? In the talk, you mentioned adalimumab, but what about other biologics? We often stop methotrexate. Are you suggesting we shouldn't?
So this is a really good question, Oliver. I think a lot of studies are done in the context of uveitis, adalimumab and adalimumab related autoantibodies. There's no reason, there's no scientific reason to think that this will not be a case for other biologics. I think since we have become more familiar, we try to keep patients even on a very minimal dose of methotrexate as well to avoid any element of developing autoantibodies. In relation to should we be doing this with the other biologics as well, I think we should. And where possible, if we can check antibodies, which is not very easy to check, this can also, you know, guide us to make the right decision. In our practice, in Alderhey, we try to keep our patients on small dose of DMARD whilst they are still on biologic, unless there is a significant reason, for example, persistent abnormal liver function, and therefore, and in some patients we have started now checking their antibodies. So I think those patients who are on biologics and we fail to keep them on methotrexate, if they are moving, switching from one biologic to other and not getting remission, it's important to then ask lab and check their antibodies to make sure that this is not why they're not responding.
Thank you. We've got another question here from Pankaj, who's asked, what is the most safe and common anti-inflammatory medicine? And for pain, are there any safe medicines for children that can be taken orally?
I'm sure when you read the side effects, even for paracetamol, there are so many that nothing is safe, but we tend to use ibuprofen in younger children in a higher dose, so like 30 milligram per kilogram, and naproxen in older patients, again a slightly higher dose, in like an arthritis dose as well. So they were, with both naproxen and ibuprofen, we tend to use omeprazole as well. Very small number of patients who develop pain due to chronic arthritis and develop mechanical pain not related to inflammation but related to long-standing arthritis, diclofenac is also a very useful pain relief medication. It's not really which one is better than other. It's which works better for some patients. And so if you are not getting good response from ibuprofen or naproxen, then there's no harm in trying ibuprofen. However, arthritis is usually not a very painful condition. So I'll be very, very concerned if my patient who has a diagnosis of arthritis is coming and telling me that they are waking up every night with significant pain. There's either something else going on, or maybe sometimes they develop pain amplification responses. So I think a lot of pain in arthritis patient is unusual, and this demands a detailed, careful examination and thinking about malignancy as well.
Thank you, Kamran. A question from Sid. I know it might be difficult to answer, but what is the best single drug?
I think best single drug is intra-articular steroid injection in the context of oligo-GIA. However, I think it's, if you want me to tell which one is better in terms of methotrexate versus biologic versus second or third line biologic, it really depends what works for some patients. You know, a lot of us think that tocilizumab is a really good medication, but we have a number of patients who haven't responded to tocilizumab. And similarly, a lot of us think that adalimumab is amazing medication for uveitis-related arthritis, but in some patients it doesn't work. So I think it's not possible to put your money on one single medication, but if you want to, joint injection will definitely work all the time when you do it.
Thank you. So we've got another question here, which is role of local applications of any medications in general and any other methods like ice packs, as there are few instructions for families.
Sorry, Jody, can you repeat it? I'm sorry about the connection.
Sorry, so it says, is there a role of local applications of any medications in general and any other methods like ice packs? There are few instructions for families.
Definitely a symptomatic treatment of pain. There's no harm. So ice packs, rubbing, massage. If the question is related to managing pain in arthritis, then definitely there is a role of all these things. So, you know, ointments, rubbing, massage, ice packs, heat packs, sitting in warm showers. But if there is a question about whether these medication has any role in controlling arthritis, then I don't think they have any role in controlling arthritis. If the question was about, is there any use of you, if there's any benefit of using topical anesthetics such as Emla cream in these patients when we give them medication, then yes, there's definitely some of our patients who are needle phobic, they get Emla cream and cold sprays, which helps them with the pain related to their medication. I would reiterate the point that I previously made, that I'll be very anxious about patient who complains of a lot of pain with arthritis, because it is unusual to have a lot of pain with arthritis. Arthritis pain never gets worse with physical activities unless there are mechanical features. And so I think one should be very careful in increasing pain relief medication, thinking that this is due to flare up of arthritis.
Thank you, Kamran. And this is the last question from Pankaj again. How and what to monitor in methotrexate by a general pediatrician?
So that's a very good question. Because of time, I didn't include monitoring slides in this in my presentation. For methotrexate, right at the beginning, before we start methotrexate, what we need is blood counts, liver function test, renal function test, and it's good practice to check their varicella and measles status before we start any immunosuppression. Once we start methotrexate, then we need to check full blood count, inflammatory markers like CRP, ESR, uricase, and LFT. So these are five tests that we do initially once a month for 3 months and then every 3 months. If any patient who has abnormal liver function, the main reason that we check, we do monitoring bloods, then depending upon how abnormal is abnormal, either methotrexate can be stopped temporarily, and then once the liver function is normalized, it can be restarted on a smaller dose. Or if there's only a mild abnormality, then the dose of methotrexate can be decreased.
Thank you, Kamran. One last question. Do you still add lidocaine before intraarticular injections for the steroids?
Yes, we do. Personally, I'm not sure how much it affects, but I would definitely recommend it for smaller joints such as fingers, subtalars, toes, where it can be quite painful after the joint injection. However, I think it's up to individual to use it for example, knees and ankles and elbows and wrists. But we in Aldehyde, we do use a tiny bit of lidocaine before we inject it.
Thank you, Cameron. We've got an anonymous question here. Do you also do hepatitis screen before starting MTX?
No, we don't. But this is that doesn't mean that where there is significant incidence of hepatitis in countries where there is significant incidence of hepatitis, I think it's reasonable to check it. We do check hepatitis B and C before we start on patients on the rituximab.
Thank you very much, Kamran. I think that's the end of the questions, actually. You did really well. There were a number of questions there. So thank you so much. Thank you so much for a fantastic session. We will conclude this today. So just to inform our colleagues who have joined from across the globe, I can see a number of people have joined today again. So the sessions will be happening every week on Wednesday, 4 o'clock UK time. We have an interesting session next week on recurrent abdominal pain from one of our gastroenterology consultants. So please do join. The link is available on the Aldehyde website. You can simply Google as Aldehyde Academy and you'll be able to see the series of talks and the links for the talks as well. And all these sessions will be recorded, and the recording from these sessions will be available on the Aldehyde Academy website as well. Thank you very much and have a nice evening. Thank you.